أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم.
ألف لام ميم. ألف لام ميم. These are three letters. The first one is ألف. The second one is لام. And the third one is ميم. And each of them is read. It is pronounced separately. In the sense that you don't say ألم. You don't say ألم. How do you say? ألف لام ميم. ذلك. ذلك means that. الكتاب. How can you break this word up? Al meaning the and kitabu meaning book. Are you familiar with the word kitab? Book. La, no, raiba, any doubt. La. We did this word earlier in Surah Al-Fatiha. غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. So la, not, you're already familiar with this word. Raiba. Raib means doubt. Fihi, in it. Fihi is two words. The first one is fi and the other one is he. Fi means in and he means it. Alright? Fi means in and he means it. Hudan, guidance. We did the word ihdina earlier. You're familiar with the word huda. Huda, guidance. Lilmuttaqeen, such a big word. Li, have you done this word earlier? Alhamdu lillahi, for Allah. This is the same li. Lilmuttaqeen, for those who have taqwa. So li means for. And then we have the second lam which has a sukoon on it, which is actually an al. What does al mean? The. So lil means for the. Okay? For the. For who? Muttaqeen. Muttaqi is one who has taqwa. Have you heard of the word muttaqi before? Such and such is a muttaqi. Okay? What does muttaqi mean? One who has taqwa. What is the meaning of taqwa? We'll go into that later on. And the een is of plural. Just as you have muslimin, alameen, muttaqeen. Right? So, lil muttaqeen, for those who have taqwa. For those who are God-fearing. Alladhina. Alladhina, those who. The al at the beginning gives the meaning of the. Ladhina, ones who. Alladhina, those who. Yu'minuna. They believe. Yu'minuna. First of all, we have the letter ya at the beginning. And whenever you see the letter ya at the beginning of a word, generally, not every time, but generally, it gives the meaning of a verb. Okay? So when you see ya at the beginning of a word, what kind of a word is it grammatically? A verb, not a noun. And a verb means an action is being done. Right? So yu'minuna. They believe. They're doing the action of believing. So yu'minuna, they believe. Hamza mim nun indicates iman, and the waw nun at the end again is plural. If the word was yu'minu, that means he believes. And if the word is yu'minuna, what does that mean? They believe. Alright? Bil ghaybi. Bi. What does bi mean? With. Bismillahi. Bi with. Ism, name. Over here we have bi with al-ghayb, the unseen. You're familiar with al. Al means the. And you have ghayb, which is unseen. Wa and yuqimuna. Again, yuqimuna begins with a ya, which means it's a verb. Alright? So yuqimuna, they're doing some action. Right? The waw noon at the end indicates plural is doing an action, which is why it's not he, but it is they. What is the action that they are doing? Of yuqimuna. Qaf, ya mim that you see over here. Okay? It means to perfectly establish. So yuqimuna, they perfectly establish. Alright? What do they perfectly establish? As-salata, the prayer. Al means the and salata, prayer. So wa yuqimuna salata, and they perfectly establish the prayer. Wa and, we've done the word wa several times before now. Mimma. Mimma is a combination of two words. Min and ma. What does min mean? From. A'udhu billahi minash shaitani rajim. You've already done the word min. I told you there's so much repetition in the Quran. Right? So min means from, and ma means what or that which. Right? Ma means what or that which. So wa mimma and from that which. Razaqnahum. Razaq, rizq, provision. Na means we. Na means we. Have we done this earlier? Where? Ihdina, guide us, plural. Right? But similarly, razaqna, we provided. We provided who? Whom? Them. We read alayhim earlier. Him is one form, and whom is another form. غَيْرِ الْمَغْضُوبِ عَلَيْهِمْ, upon them. رَزَقْنَا هُمْ, we provided them. Right? يُنْفِقُونَ, they spend. Again, ya at the beginning indicates it's a verb. نَفَقَ means to spend. وَاوْنُونَ is of plural. So يُنْفِقُونَ, they spend. وَالَّذِينَ, and those who. Do I need to break this down? No. يُؤْمِنُونَ, they believe. Do I need to break this down? We've done this before, right? Ya indicates verb. Hamza Mim Noon indicates iman. And waw noon, plural. So يُؤْمِنُونَ, they believe. They have faith. بِمَا أُنزِلَ. بِمَا is a combination of bi and ma. You've done bi earlier, you've done ma earlier, right? Bi means with. Ma means what or that which. Then we have unzila. Unzila means it was revealed. So bima unzila, in that which was revealed. Unzila, nazala, tanzil, one of the names of the Quran. Okay, revelation. So unzila, it was revealed. Ilaika, towards you. Ila. Ila means towards. And ka means you. Have we done ka earlier? Where? Iyaka. نَعْبُدُ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ. So over here we have إِلَيْكَ, towards you. وَمَا أُنزِلَ, and what was revealed. مِن, from, قَبْلِكَ, before you. مِن means from, you've done this before. قَبْلِكَ. قَبْلِكَ is a combination of two words. The first one is قَبْل, which means before. And the second is كَ, which means you. So قَبْلِكَ, before you. وَبِالْآخِرَةِ, and with the hereafter. Wa means and, bi means with, al means the, akhira means hereafter. Easy? Okay. وَبِالْآخِرَةِ, and with the hereafter. Whom, they, again this word is coming. What do they do? يُوقِنُونَ, they believe with certainty. يُوقِنُونَ, يُؤْمِنُونَ, يقيمون, they sound so similar, isn't it? Because they're all verbs. They begin with ya and with waunun, which means it's plural. So they, what is the action that they're doing? Of yaqeen. So they believe with certainty. Just as yu'minuna, what action is it that they're doing? Of iman. So they have faith. Yuqimuna, what action is it that they're doing? Of establishing. So yu'minuna, they believe. Yuqimuna, they perfectly establish. يُنْفِقُونَ, they spend. And يُوقِنُونَ, they believe with certainty. They have yaqeen. أُولَٰئِكَ, those. This is new. أُولَٰئِكَ, those. عَلَىٰ, upon. We did عَلَيْهِمْ earlier, right? عَلَىٰ, upon. هُدًى, a guidance. مِنْ, from. رَبِّهِمْ, their Lord. رَبِّهِمْ is two words. The first one is رَبْ, رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ, Lord, Master. We did that earlier. And him means there. So مِنْ رَبِّهِمْ, from their Lord. وَ, and أُولَٰئِكَ, those, whom they. الْمُفْلِحُونَ, those who are successful. الْمُفْلِحُونَ, Al means the. Now we're left with muflihun. The wawnun at the end indicates that this is a plural. Right? And you see muflih, what do you think the root letters are? Falamha. Okay? So what's this meme? This meme indicates that the word is a noun. This indicates that the word is a noun. So muflih is who? The person who is successful. The one who is successful. So al-muflihun, what does that mean? The ones who are successful. Those who are successful. It's a noun. It's people. It's not a verb. Okay? It's people. The ones, those people who are successful. Alright? Any questions so far? Everything is clear? The meme. Al-muflih. Fa, lam, ha are the root letters. And meme indicates that the word is a noun. Which kind of a noun is it? Active participle, meaning one who does the action. Generally. Inshallah, as you will become more and more familiar with the words, you will be able to recognize when the meme indicates noun. Okay? When the ya indicates verb. But generally, this is what it is.
Let's listen to the recitation.
Surah Al-Baqarah is a Madani surah. Surah Al-Fatiha was Makki. What does that mean? That Surah Al-Fatiha was revealed before the Hijrah. Surah Al-Baqarah is Madani. What does that mean? That it was revealed after the Hijrah. So Surah Al-Baqarah is a Madani surah. It was revealed after the Hijrah. Makki and Madani has to do with the time and not the place. Makki does not mean it was revealed in Mecca. Madani does not mean it was revealed in Medina. Because after the Hijrah, the Prophet ﷺ did go back to Mecca as well. Okay? And he came back. I mean, he visited Mecca and he returned to Medina. So Makki and Madani has to do with the era, the time, not the place. Because all the revelation was not sent only in Mecca, only in Medina. There were other places as well where the Prophet ﷺ was at certain times, and the wahi was given to him. So Makki means before the migration, and Madani means after the migration. Surah Al-Baqarah is the longest chapter of the Qur'an. It is the longest surah of the Qur'an. And it covers about 2.5 juz. It covers about 2.5 juz of the Qur'an. How many verses does this surah have? 286. 286. Literally, Al-Baqarah means the cow. And the surah is named after the story of the cow that is mentioned in verses 67 to 73, which inshallah we shall study soon. So Al-Baqarah literally means the cow, and the surah is named after the story of the cow that is mentioned in the verses 67 to 73. As for the importance of the surah, there is a hadith that is mentioned in several hadith books. For example, there is a narration that we find in Sahih Muslim. Abdullah ibn Buraydah narrated from his father that I was sitting with the Prophet ﷺ and I heard him say, تَعَلَّمُوا سُورَةَ الْبَقَرَةِ فَإِنَّ أَخْذَهَا بَرَكَةِ وَتَرْكَهَا حَسْرَةِ وَلَا تَسْتَطِيعُهَا الْبَطَلَةِ. Learn Surah Al-Baqarah. تَعَلَّمُوا, learn, not just read. Not just recite, but learn. Learn the meaning. Learn the ahkam that are mentioned in the surah. Why? Because in learning it, there is blessing. In learning it, there is blessing. In ignoring it, there is sorrow. In ignoring the surah, not studying it, not learning it, there is sorrow. There is grief. There is regret for a person. And the evil ones, they cannot memorize the surah. And then it is said that Abdullah ibn Buraydah, when he was narrating from his father, he said that he kept silent for a while, and then he said, تَعَلَّمُوا سُورَةَ الْبَقَرَةِ وَآلَ عِمْرَانِ فَإِنَّهُمَا الزَّهْرَوَانِ يُضِلَّانِ صَاحِبَهُمَا يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ كَأَنَّهُمَا غَمَامَتَانِ أَوْ غَيَايَتَانِ أو فرقان من طير صواف. Learn Surah Al-Baqarah and Surah Ali Imran. Learn what? Which surahs? Surah Al-Baqarah and Surah Ali Imran. Why? Because they are two lights. These two surahs are two lights. What does a light do? It guides you. It shows you the way. It illuminates your surroundings. It makes you more aware. It helps you. It benefits you. So these two surahs, they are two lights. And they will shade their people on the day of resurrection. What does it mean by they will shade their people on the day of resurrection? Those people who learn them, who read them. So these two surahs will shade their people on the day of resurrection just as two clouds or two spaces of shade or two lines of flying birds. Two lines of flying birds. Just as they shade those who are under them. So Surah Al-Baqarah is a very special surah. Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu, he said that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, لا تجعلوا بيوتكم مقابر. Do not make your houses into graveyards. Do not turn your houses into graveyards. فَإِنَّ الْبَيْتَ الَّذِي تُقْرَأُ فِيهِ سُورَةُ الْبَقَرَةِ لَا يَدُخُلُهُ الشَّيْطَانِ. Verily, Shaytan does not enter the house where Surah Al-Baqarah is recited. And this is mentioned in At-Tirmidhi as well as Sahih Muslim. So what do we learn from this hadith? That the house in which the Qur'an is not recited, that house is like a graveyard. When you go to a graveyard, how do you feel? Scared, terrified, lonely. There's sadness, there's emptiness. And a house in which the Qur'an is not recited, that house also becomes lonely. A place where a person does not find contentment and happiness. So do not turn your houses into graveyards by not reciting the Qur'an in your houses. And the Prophet ﷺ told us that the house in which Surah Al-Baqarah is recited, Shaytan does not enter. Shaytan does not enter into that house. So what if Shaytan enters your house? What is he going to do? You can't see him. How is he going to spread corruption? Make trouble and fights and arguments between the people. Many times people are living under the same roof. But every time they see each other, they argue. There is no peace. There is no happiness. The wealth that comes in the house, there is no barakah. The money that comes into the house, the food that comes into the house, there is no barakah. Why? Because Shaytan is there. So don't turn your houses into graveyards and read Surah Al-Baqarah so that Shaytan does not enter the house. Let's begin this surah. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. The Basmala, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, is a constant verse. It is a mustaqila ayah that is recited at the beginning of every surah except for Surah At-Tawbah. Except for Surah At-Tawbah. Okay, at the beginning of Surah At-Tawbah, you do not recite the Basmala. But as for the other surahs, all of them, you recite Basmala before them. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Alif, Lam, Mim. Alif, Lam, Mim. Did you notice something? We did not translate these letters from Arabic into English. We do not translate them as A-L-M. Or we do not give a meaning to them. We keep them exactly as they are. Alif, Lam, Mim. These letters, Alif, Lam, Mim, they are of the Huruful Hija. They are of the Arabic alphabet. They are of the Arabic alphabet. They are written together, as you can see. Lam and Mim are joined together. But they are pronounced separately. They are read separately. In the sense that you don't put any haraka on the letters to join them together. You do not put a fatha on the alif to join it with lam, alam. No, you don't do that. You read it as alif, lam, and me. Nor do you read them as a, l, m. But you actually say the name of the letter. What is the name of this letter? Alif. The next letter, lam. The third letter, Meem. And because they are read separately, they are pronounced separately. This is why they have been given the term حروف مقطعات. حروف مقطعات. What does it mean by that? The disjointed letters. Those letters that are not joined together. مقطعات is from قطع. And قطع means to cut. قاطع الرحم. One who severs the relationships. You may have heard. Right? So مقطعات, the disjointed letters. 14 of the Arabic alphabet, they appear at the beginning of 29 surahs of the Quran in this way. 14 of the Arabic alphabet appear at the beginning of 29 surahs of the Quran in this way. What are they called? حروف مقطعات. And there are many opinions regarding the meanings and the purpose of these letters, of the حروف مقطعات. But mainly, you can summarize them. First of all, it has been said that these حروف, they have a meaning. Just as the letter ba has a meaning, just as any word in the Quran has a meaning, similarly, these حروف also have some meaning. And the scholars have differed concerning their exact meaning. Some say that it is the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or the Quran, or it is equivalent to an oath that is taken. However, we do not have any sound evidence to support that. So first of all, it is said that these huruf, they have some meaning, just as the other words of the Quran have some meaning. However, we do not have any evidence to support that. Therefore, let's look at the second opinion. Secondly, it is said that these huruf, huruf muqatta'a, they are of the huruf hija'iyya, they are of the Arabic alphabet, because you say alif, you say lam, you say meem. Just as you say alif, you say ba, you say ta. So similarly, these letters are of the huruf hija'iyya, of the Arabic alphabet, and they do not have a meaning. You cannot translate them. You cannot translate them. When you see the letter B, how do you translate it? With. When you see the letter Li, how do you translate that? For. But when you see Alif, when you see Lam, Mim, in this way, do you translate this into something? You don't. So this is the second opinion. Thirdly, it has been said that these letters, they have some meaning. They do have some meaning. And because we have not been informed of the exact meaning, therefore, it is incorrect to guess, to speculate, to assume. We leave these letters as they are. We believe them to be as a part of the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not tell us precisely as to what their meaning is. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not tell us about what their meaning is. But do we believe in these letters? Of course we do. They are part of the Quran. Nobody can deny that. And reading these letters, is there any reward? Yes, there is. For every letter that a person recites of the Quran, he gets 10 rewards, 10 good deeds. And Alif Lam Mim is included in that. You know the hadith which says, وَلَا أَقُولُ أَلِفْ لَا مِيمْ حَرْفْ بَلْ أَلِفٌ حَرْفْ. Alif is a harf, lam is a harf, and meem is a harf. So even when a person just says alif, lam, meem, he gets 30 good deeds. They are part of the Quran. They are part of the words of the Quran. Now you may wonder, if they have a meaning, we don't know. Others say they don't have a meaning. How can there be something in the Quran that does not have a meaning? How is that possible? So other scholars, they have said, and this has been understood and accepted as the strongest opinion, that these letters, the حروف مقطعات, yes, they do not have a literal meaning, however, they have a purpose. They have a purpose. They have no meaning, but they have a purpose. There is a reason why they are mentioned in the Quran in the way that they are mentioned. There is a reason behind that. For example, some have said that the purpose is to draw the attention of the listener. Because alif, lam, meem, you see the mad on the lam, how do you read it? Alif, lam, meem. When you hear that automatically, you wonder, what's going on? What has been said? So the purpose is to attract the attention of the listeners. Secondly, it has also been said that the Arabs, they are being reminded that this Qur'an is composed of their own letters, of the letters that they're so aware of. The words are the same as their words, and yet they cannot produce anything that is like the Qur'an. The letters are the same. Alif, Lam, Mim. You use these letters all the time. The words are the same. You use these words all the time. But can you produce a kalam that is even similar to this book? To the kalam of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? No, you cannot. So in other words, the purpose of these letters is to display the miraculous nature of the Qur'an. What's the purpose of mentioning these letters in this way? What's the purpose? To express, to display the miraculous nature of the Qur'an. This Qur'an is a miracle. You have the same letters, but you cannot bring anything close to this. You cannot make anything close to this. You cannot say anything close to this. We hear about so many famous poets who were known for their poetry. One of them, when he heard Suratul Kawthar, he never said any poetry after that. He accepted his defeat after that. He said, that's it. My kalam is nothing compared to the kalam of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So these letters, they prove the miraculous nature of the Qur'an, that the Qur'an cannot be challenged. And if you notice, they're almost always followed by such verses that exalt the status of the Qur'an. Many times that when they appear in the Qur'an, at the beginning of the surahs, what ayah follows them? An ayah that exalts the status of the Qur'an. For example, over here, what do you read? Alif, Lam, Mim. ذَلِكَ الْكِتَابُ لَا رَيْبَ فِيهِ. This is a book in which there is no doubt at all. So such letters, they are followed by the حروف مقطعات, they are followed by a verse that exalts the status of the Qur'an. Almost always, not every time, but almost always in the Qur'an. So Alif Lam Mim, ذَلِكَ الْكِتَابُ. This is the book. لَا رَيْبَ فِيهِ, in which there is no doubt. ذَلِكَ. ذَلِكَ means that. And the word ذَلِكَ is called ism ishara in the Arabic language. When you hear ism, what comes to your mind? Noun. When you hear ishara, what comes to your mind? To point. Ishara, to point to something. Okay? So, ism ishara, ذَلِكَ is an ism ishara, and it is used to point towards something, to refer to something. Just as you have in English, that. Why do you use the word that? To point towards something. That book. This book. Those people. Okay? So this is what ism ishara is. And ذَلِكَ in particular, this is that ism ishara, which is ba'id, meaning it is used to point to something that is far. Just as you have that, which is used to point to something that is far, and you have this, which is used to point to something that is near. So, ذَلِكَ الْكِتَابُ, that book. What does ذَلِكَ mean? What does that indicate? That it is pointing towards something that is far. And this is understood in two ways. First of all, that literally, that which is being pointed towards is actually far. And secondly, this word is used, ism ishara ba'id is used, because you're pointing towards something that is very exalted in its status. It is very high in its status. It is very high in its status. So why is ذَلِكَ used? ذَلِكَ الْكِتَابُ. That is the book. By the way, the book refers to what? The Qur'an. So why is ذَلِكَ used? First of all, to express the greatness, the importance, the high status of the Qur'an. Because it is the kalam of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is not an ordinary kalam. It is not an ordinary book. It is the word of Allah. It is exalted. Therefore, ذَلِكَ. And from this we learn that the person who accepts this book, the person who carries this book, the person who learns this book, the person who applies this book, obviously, he is also going to be of a high status in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Just as, you know, if there's a particular city, a particular area, in which the elite live. So any person who lives there, what does that mean? That he is also of the elite. Right? Similarly, if there is a particular club or a particular association or whatever, and only the elite have, you know, membership of that particular club. So if a person has the membership of that club, what does that mean? That he is also of the elite. So similarly, if this kitab is of exalted status, the hamil al-Qur'an, the sahib al-Qur'an, the one who carries this book, the companion of the Qur'an, the one who recites, the one who memorizes, the one who reads, the one who learns, the one who applies, he is also going to be of exalted status in the sight of Allah. What did we learn in the hadith? That خَيْرُكُمْ مَنْ تَعَلَّمَ الْقُرْآنَ وَعَلَّمَهُ. The best of you is who? Is who? The one who learns the Qur'an and teaches it. So first of all, ذَلِكَ has been used to express the greatness of the status of the Qur'an. Secondly, it has also been said that ذَلِكَ has been used to point to the original Qur'an. Not the Qur'an that is in front of you, but the original Qur'an. And where is that? In the Lawh al-Mahfuz. And the Lawh al-Mahfuz is up in the seventh heaven. It is far. It's quite far. So ذَلِكَ is pointing towards the actual book, which is in the Lawh al-Mahfuz. Where do we learn that from? From Surah al-Buruj, ayah number 21 and 22, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, بَلْ هُوَ قُرْآنٌ مَجِيدٌ فِي لَوْحٍ مَحْفُوظٍ. But this is an honored Qur'an inscribed in a preserved tablet, in a preserved slate. Surah al-Buruj, ayahs 21 and 22. So ذَلِكَ الْكِتَابِ, that is the book, this exalted book, this glorious book, this great book. And as for the word kitab, kitab is from the root kaf ta ba. What does kitab mean? Book, right? And kitab is from kaf ta ba, katb. And katb means jam', to collect, to gather together. What does katb mean? Al jam', to gather together, to collect. So in a book, words, chapters, facts, information, stories, sometimes statistics, details, all of these are joined together. They are gathered together in one book. The information that is scattered, what's the purpose of a book? What's the purpose of a book? Put it together in one cover. Right? So this is the meaning of kitab. And kitab gives the meaning of maktub, that which is written. And kataba yaktubu means to write, to record. So kitab is that which is recorded, that which is written. So ذَلِكَ الْكِتَابِ, that is the book. What about this book? Allah tells us, لَا رَيْبَ فِيهِ. There is absolutely no doubt in it. What does لَا mean? Not. رَيْب, doubt. فِيهِ, in it. What does it mean by رَيْب? رَيْب is from the root letters رَا, يَا, ba. And raib means doubt. But there are many other words in the Arabic language that also mean doubt. For example, the word shak. Many of you may have heard the word shak. Shak means doubt. But what kind of doubt is raib? It is said that raib is such a doubt that creates unrest in a person. What kind of a doubt is it? That creates unrest in a person. It makes a person unsettled. He is not satisfied anymore. So it is a state of being unsure. It is a state of being shaky. You know, sometimes you wonder, should I or should I not? Is it true or is it not? What happens? It continues to bother you until you actually find out what the reality is. Right? For example, sometimes you're not sure if a particular food has gone bad, and you smell it and you're like, is it bad or is it not? Right? And it makes you so restless. And you go and ask other people, what do you think? Do you think this has gone bad? Do you think this is still okay? It takes your peace away, doesn't it? It takes your peace away. So raib is doubt which creates unrest in a person. It makes him unsettled. It is a state of being shaky. It is a state of being unsure. It is said in Arabic, دع ما يريبك إلى ما لا يريبك. Leave that which puts you to doubt for that which does not put you in doubt. So anything that makes you doubtful, leave it. And take what? That which does not make you doubtful. Living in the West, when you go buy food, what happens? There is a particular ingredient and you're not sure. Is it halal or is it not? You're not sure. Maybe. What if? Then what should you do? دَعْ مَا يُرِيبُكَ. Leave that which puts you to doubt. And take what? Take that which does not put you to doubt. Okay? So لَا رَيْبَ. This is the book, لَا رَيْبَ. There is no doubt فِيهِ in it. Now you see, لَا رَيْبَ, the way that this is structured, this conveys the meaning of there is absolutely no doubt. Any doubt. لَا رَيْبَ, no doubt at all. A lot or a little. Sometimes, when you're doubtful about something, you're sure about 60%, and you're unsure about 40%. Right? Allah tells us, لَا رَيْبَ فِيهِ, there is no doubt in it. In other words, everything in the Qur'an is factual. You should be 100% confident when you're reading this Qur'an, when you're listening to the Qur'an. 100% confident. Don't be 50-50. Don't be 60-40. Don't be 95-5. Be 100% sure. لَا رَيْبَ فِيهِ, there is no doubt in it. Now what does it mean by there is no doubt in the Qur'an? This has been understood in three ways. First of all, there is no doubt in the Qur'an in the fact that this book has been sent by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There is no doubt in the fact that this book has been sent by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. لَا رَيْبَ فِيهِ. No doubt at all. It has definitely been sent by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Secondly, it also means that there is no doubt in the fact that the Qur'an constitutes the correct guidance for man. It has the correct guidance for the human beings. So when you're reading the Qur'an, when you're studying the Qur'an, and you come across a command, you come across a prohibition, you come across an instruction, be sure that this is best for me. This is best for us. Why? Why? Why shouldn't you doubt it? Because it is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And He knows us more and better than we know ourselves. So there is no doubt in it, in the fact that what is in the Qur'an is indeed best for the human beings. Thirdly, there is no doubt in it, meaning in the fact that there is nothing incorrect in it. So everything in the Qur'an is absolutely correct. It is factual. Everything that is mentioned in the Qur'an is indeed a fact. You know, sometimes you're reading a book and they've mentioned some statistics or something and you're like, I don't think I can accept that. I don't think I can believe that. But if it is something that is mentioned in the Qur'an, it is a fact. Be sure. Have that confidence. Be 100% sure. Completely trust this book. ذَلِكَ الْكِتَابُ لَا رَيْبَ فِيهِ. So this is the book in which there is no doubt, no uncertainty. When you're reading it, you can be sure. You can be confident. You can read it with peace of mind, with peace of heart, that what you're reading is indeed true. ذَلِكَ الْكِتَابُ لَا رَيْبَ فِيهِ. What about this Qur'an? Why was this Qur'an sent? Why was this book sent? Allah tells us. What does the ayah say? What does the ayah say? Everybody read together. هُدًى لِلْمُتَّقِينَ. It is a guide for who? For those who have taqwa. هُدًى. It is a guidance. We have done the meaning of the word hidayah. What does it mean? To show the way, to make the person walk on the way, and to make them reach the destination as well. So if a person adheres to the Qur'an, this Qur'an will lead him to the destination. What is the destination? The approval of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. هُدًى لِلْمُتَّقِينَ. It is a guide for those who have taqwa. Muttaqeen are those people who have taqwa. What is taqwa? Have you heard of the word taqwa before? Love for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. God consciousness, being conscious of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, being aware of Allah, consciousness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which takes a person towards obedience and keeps him away from sinning. Being conscious of the fact that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is seeing us, is watching us. Let's look at the literal meaning of the word. Taqwa, or muttaqi, is from the root letters waw, qaf, ya. Do you see waw? You don't. It is of the huruf illa. Waw, qaf, ya. Taqwa is from waw, qaf, ya. And wiqaya means to take protection. To take protection. To take a shield. When do you take a shield? When do you protect yourself? From what? From something that is dangerous. From something that is harmful. So taqwa is to take wiqaya from the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. From the anger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. From the disapproval of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What is taqwa? To take wiqaya, to take protection. From what? From the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And how is that done? By doing what He has commanded and abstaining from what He has forbidden. This is what taqwa is. Taqwa is to take protection from what? Against what? Against the punishment of Allah. How will you do that? How will you be safe from the punishment of Allah? When you do that which pleases Allah, and when you don't do that which makes Him upset. So muttaqeen are those who have taqwa. Now you tell me, is it important to have taqwa? Why? In order to seek, in order to gain the approval of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you have to obey Him. You have to stay away from that which upsets Him. You have to stay away from that which He has forbidden. Over here Allah says, Hudan lilmuttaqeen. The Qur'an is a guide for who? For those who have taqwa. So what does that mean? That only when a person has taqwa, he will receive the guidance from the Qur'an. Only when a person has taqwa, he will receive the guidance from the Qur'an. Which means that if a person does not have taqwa, he will not necessarily benefit from the guidance that is in the Qur'an. You see, we take so much precaution in our lives, isn't it? We won't go out in the heat. We'll take care of our hair to such lengths. We'll take care of our skin. We'll take care of our house. And we'll protect our things. We'll take insurance. We do so much to stay protected. So much. We go through so much effort, so much difficulty. We spend so much of our wealth, our money, our time in order to be protected. Why? To just have a good life. To have some benefits. But we should be concerned about the life that is eternal. The life that is in the hereafter. And we have to protect ourselves right now. How? By obeying Allah and by abstaining from disobeying Him. Umar ibn al-Khattab, he asked Ubay about what taqwa is. And he replied that, have you ever taken a path between thorny bushes? Have you ever taken a path between thorny bushes? Have you ever tried to walk through thorny bushes? He replied, yes. He said, what did you do? You tell me, what would you do? If you're trying to walk through thorny bushes, if you're trying to walk through a place where there are thorny bushes, what are you going to do? You're going to avoid the thorns, and what else? You're going to protect yourself. Umar ibn al-Khattab said that I gathered in my clothes and I was careful. I gathered in my clothes and I was careful. You know, many times when we're wearing a hijab or an abaya or something, right? If we're walking through such a place, what are you going to do? Immediately you're going to gather it up together. And you're going to become careful as well. So Ubay said, that is taqwa. That a person lives in a way that he is conscious of his surroundings and he takes protection. Because the thorns, they're like sins. They're like sins. They call us to disobedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Taqwa is to protect yourself and don't get hurt by those thorns. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us that the Qur'an is hudan lilmuttaqeen. It is a guide for those who have taqwa. But elsewhere in the Qur'an, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that the Qur'an is hudan linnas. It is a guide for mankind. It is a guide for all people. Is there a contradiction? Over here we read, هُدَى لِلْمُتَّقِينَ, a guide for those who have taqwa. At another place in the Qur'an we read, هُدَى لِلنَّاسِ, a guide for all mankind. The Qur'an has been sent as a guide for everybody, for all mankind. However, it is only the muttaqeen who will benefit from the guidance. Why? Because they will take the message of the Qur'an. Next ayah. So we see that in order to benefit from the guidance that is offered in the Qur'an, we have to have taqwa. But what is taqwa? How does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describe those people who have taqwa? In the following verses. Right? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us that the muttaqeen, who are they? الَّذِينَ يُؤْمِنُونَ بِالْغَيْبِ, those who believe in the unseen. وَيُقِيمُونَ الصَّلَاةَ, and they establish the prayer. وَمِمَّا رَزَقْنَاهُمْ يُنْفِقُونَ, and spend out of what we have provided for them. There are some new words over here. Let's look at them first. الَّذِينَ يُؤْمِنُونَ, those people who believe. يُؤْمِنُونَ is from the root letters Hamza, Meem, Noon. Have you heard of the term Iman? It's from the same root. What does Iman mean? Faith, belief. So يُؤْمِنُونَ, they have faith, they believe in. And Iman means to affirm something, to accept something. Basically, it has been said that Iman is to acknowledge something to be true on the tongue. So to acknowledge the truthfulness of something at the tongue. The next level after that is to accept it as true in the heart. Okay? So for example, when a person says, yes, I believe that Allah is the only one and true God. For example, when a person says that, he is making a statement. Right? So he says something to be true how? At his tongue. And he doesn't just say it, he believes the truthfulness of this statement in his heart as well. But this is not all what Iman is about. There is a third level to Iman. And what is that? Actions. To prove the statement to be true, how? Through one's actions. So when a person says, I believe in Allah, and in his heart, he tells himself that I believe in Allah, he has his firm belief, then what do his actions show? That he prays to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He fears Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So, الَّذِينَ يُؤْمِنُونَ, those people who believe in. So what does it mean by this? That they believe in, they accept, and they affirm the truthfulness of الْغَيْب, of the unseen. الَّذِينَ يُؤْمِنُونَ بِالْغَيْبِ. Now the word غَيْب is from the root غَيْن يَابَ. غَيْن يَابَ. And غَيْب means the unseen. What does it mean? The unseen. That which is hidden. Basically غَيْب is used for something that is hidden. غَائِب is from the same root. غَائِب is one who is absent. So one who is absent, one who is not there, he is hidden from your eyes. You cannot see him. Because he's not there. He is elsewhere. The word ghiba. What does ghiba mean? Backbiting. That is also from the same root. Why? Because backbiting is done behind another person's back. While he is absent. While he is not there. Right? So ghaib is that which is hidden. That which is not visible to us. So ghaib is technically all that is beyond and hidden from the human sight and senses. What is ghaib? All that is beyond and hidden from the human sight and senses. We learned that a place in which people gather together and they remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they mention Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they read the book of Allah, what happens? What happens? The angels surround them. Right? But can you see the angels at that time? No, you can't. So ghaib is that which is beyond and hidden from the human sight and human senses. But in particular, غيب, like over here, it refers to all those things that we are supposed to believe in without even seeing them. What does that include? First of all, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We have not seen Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but we are supposed to believe in Him. What else? The angels. What else? The Day of Judgment. What else? Jannah. What else? Now, hellfire. Huh? Jinn are also hidden from us. We do not see them. So ghaib refers to all those things that are hidden from us. We do not see them, but we are required to believe in them. If we don't believe in them, what happens? Our iman is incomplete. It is unacceptable. So let's say a person says that, okay, what's happening right now in my house, I do not see it. That is also ghaib. Linguistically it is, but technically it isn't. Because if a person refuses to believe that there is somebody at his house right now because, you know, he cannot see them, that doesn't mean that he's incomplete in his faith. No. Ghaib literally is that which is unseen and hidden, but in the context, what does it refer to? That which we are required to believe in. And if we don't believe in it, our iman is incomplete. Our iman is absent. And ghaib also includes the books of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For example, we have to believe in the Torah, the Injil. Have you actually seen the original Torah? The original Injil? No, you haven't. Did you see the tablets that were given to Musa alayhi salam? No, you didn't. Are you required to believe in them? Yes, of course. Even though you cannot see them? Yes, of course. Why? Because Allah told us. So in essence, ghaib refers to all those things that are hidden from us, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has informed us of them. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has informed us of them. And we believe in them. Why? Because Allah told us about them. It also includes all the previous messengers. Did you see Musa alayhi salam? No, you didn't. But are you supposed to believe in him? Of course. So ghaib includes, first of all, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then includes the angels, the books. According to Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu, it refers to wahi. It refers to revelation. According to others, it refers in particular to Quran. It includes the messengers. It includes Jannah, Nar, even the decree, the good and bad, the resurrection, and all else that the Quran and Sunnah tell us about, which we have not seen, but we are required to believe in them. Why are we required to believe in them? Because if we believe in Allah, anything that Allah tells us, that's going to be true. لا ريب فيه. There is no doubt in it. So whatever Allah is telling us, we believe in it. There is a very interesting story that we learn, I'll mention it to you, about what ghaib includes. Amr bin Marra, he said that the companions of Abdullah, they said to him, تَطُوبَ لَكَ. You're so lucky. Congratulations. You're so lucky. جَاهَدْتَ مَعَ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ وَجَالَسْتَهُ. You fought along with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You participated in the wars that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam participated in, and you sat in his company. فَقَالَ. So he replied that إِنَّ شَأْنَ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ كَانَ مُبَيِّنًا لِمَنْ رَآهُ. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, whoever would see him, they would know that he is a messenger. That was quite obvious. وَلَكِنْ أَعْجَبْ مِنْ ذَلِكَ. What is more amazing than that is قَوْمٌ يَجِدُونَ كِتَابًا مَكْتُوبًا. What is more amazing are the people who will only find a book that is written. يُؤْمِنُونَ بِهِ. They will believe in it. وَلَمْ يَرَوْهُ. But they did not see him. They will believe in the Qur'an, but they have not seen the Prophet ﷺ. So when the people said to him, oh, you're so lucky, you were with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you are the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, what did he say? Yes, that is good, okay, fine. That was easy. What is more amazing is the fact that there will be people after us who have not seen the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but they will still believe in the Quran. And then he recited the ayah, الَّذِينَ يُؤْمِنُونَ بِالْغَيْبِ. those who believe in the unseen. الذين يؤمنون بالغيب. The future, the past is also in ghayb. For example, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has told us that in the future, the day of judgment is going to come, we believe in that. About the past, that He created Adam alayhi salam, we believe in that. Okay? What else do they do? وَيُقِيمُونَ الصَّلَاةَ And they establish the salah. They perfectly establish the salah. يُقِيمُونَ is from the root قَاف وَاو مِيم. So الَّذِينَ يُؤْمِنُونَ بِالْغَيْبِ وَيُقِيمُونَ الصَّلَاةَ And they establish the prayer. يُقِيمُونَ is from the root قَاف وَاو مِيم. From قَامَ يَقُومُ which means literally to stand. The word قِيَام is from the same root. What is قِيَام? When you stand in prayer and recite the Qur'an. قِيَامُ اللَّيْلِ Why is it called قِيَامُ اللَّيْلِ? Because you stand most of that salah, right? And you recite the Qur'an in that. So قَامَ يَقُومُ is to stand. And إِقَامَ, from which is the word يُقِيمُونَ, إِقَامَ means to make something stand straight. What does it mean? To make something stand straight. To establish something properly. To establish something correctly. What does it mean? To establish something correctly and properly. When something rises, when something stands, when something is correct, when something is fully established. For example, it is said, أقام السوق. What is سوق? Marketplace. So أقام السوق is when the marketplace is fully established. What does it mean by that? What does it mean by that? There's a lot of hustle bustle. People are coming in, buying stuff. Lots of noise, food, shopping, this, that going on. This is أقام السوق. And if you go to the same souq in the middle of the night, that same souq is, the doors are closed. And you read in the door, mall hours are such and such. And when you go during the mall hours, what do you see? There's so much going on. So this is what أقام is. إقامة, to establish something, to fully establish it. And إقامة الصلاة, what does that mean? To establish the صلاة. Let's look at the meaning of the word صلاة first, and then we'll see what إقامة الصلاة means. صلاة, linguistically, literally, it means دعاء. Prayer. Supplication. What does صلاة mean? دعاء. Prayer. Supplication. But over here, it doesn't mean وَيُقِيمُونَ الصَّلَاةَ that they just make دعاء to Allah. No. دعاء is only the linguistic meaning. What is the meaning of salat in Sharia, in our religion? It refers to the specific words and the specific actions that are performed in a particular way. The specific words and actions that are performed in a particular way. Why is it called salat? Why is it called salat? Because we make dua in it. Isn't it? One of the first things we do is, we read is Surah Al-Fatiha. And Surah Al-Fatiha has a prayer in it. اِهْدِنَا الصِّرَاطَ الْمُسْتَقِيمِ So, وَيُقِيمُونَ الصَّلَاةَ They establish the word. Now, you may wonder that the word salat is singular. The plural of salat is salawat, isn't it? So, why is a singular word used over here? Does it mean that they only pray one prayer? Whichever one they like. Whichever one they find convenient. No. The word salat, yes, it is singular, but there's something known in Arabic which is called ism jins, the generic word, ism jins. And when an ism jins is used, it is not just limited to the singular. It may also include plural. And if it is about those things which have a masculine and feminine, it may also refer to masculine and feminine. For example, the word walad, it is singular. Generally, it is used for just a boy. But walad can include boy, girl, one, more. Because it is ism jins. Similar is the word salat. So by salat, not one salat is meant. يُقِيمُونَ الصَّلَاةَ They establish the prayer. The act of praying. The five daily prayers. The nafal salah as well. The eid salah as well. The jumu'ah salah as well. So what does it mean by establishing the prayer? When you think of establishing the prayer, iqamatu salat, what does it mean by that? That they pray consistently. They pray regularly. The 5 daily prayers, they pray them regularly. They don't just pray, okay, I prayed 3 salahs today. Enough. Good enough. I only prayed 1 last week. If I'm praying 3, it's so good. It is improvement, but iqamatu salah means all 5 daily prayers. Praying consistently. Praying regularly. What else does it mean by iqamatu salah? To have khushu' when you're praying salah. Basically, in the prescribed manner. Praying in the prescribed manner. What is a prescribed manner? That a person prays with his wudu, that a person prays face the qibla, that a person prays according to sunnah, that a person prays with khushu', with fear of Allah, with concentration, right? So secondly, iqamatu salah includes in the prescribed manners as well. What else does it include? Praying regularly, consistently, praying properly. What else? For men in particular, praying in congregation. For men in particular, praying in congregation. What else? Encouraging others to establish the prayer as well. There's one more meaning. There's one very important thing. Very important. On time. In the prescribed times. You cannot pray Maghrib at the time of Isha. You cannot pray Isha at the time of Fajr. You cannot pray Fajr at the time of Zuhr. You cannot pray Zuhr at the time of Fajr. No. Iqamatu Salah means praying in the prescribed times as well. My question is, why is it important to establish the Salah? So what if I miss out on just one or two? Or so what if I'm late on a few? I mean, what's the big deal? I pray. It's one of the first things that a person is going to be questioned about on the Day of Judgment. What else? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has decreed this on the believers, that we have to pray in a particular way at specific times. What else? For getting taqwa. A person cannot have taqwa unless and until he establishes the prayer. And is there a problem if a person does not have taqwa? What is it? They cannot receive guidance from the Quran. So,
Ar-Rahman al-Muflihun.